Hello and welcome to India's World. The 18th meeting of the South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation, or SARC, is scheduled to take place in Kathmandu from November 22nd to 27th. SARC was set up in 1985 and today it has 8 members. These are Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan and Sri Lanka. Afghanistan joined SARC only in 2007. SARC member nations cooperate on a range of issues from agriculture, economy, poverty alleviation, science and technology, and culture to encouraging people-to-people contact. Today we will discuss how relevant and cohesive has SARC been as a regional cooperative mechanism. To address this and related issues, we have with us a very distinguished panel of experts. We have with us Ambassador Kamal Sibal, a formidable diplomat. He was Foreign Secretary of India and India's ambassador to Turkey, Egypt, France and Russia, and a familiar figure on Rajya Sabha TV. We are very lucky to have with us Mr. Amir Khusro Mahmood Chaudhry. He is a prominent leader of the Bangladesh Nationalist Party. As the Commerce Minister of Bangladesh, he initiated a trade liberalization by facilitating the free trade agreement with India and is a votary of greater economic integration in the region. And we have with us my old friend, Professor Mahendra Lama. He is a professor at the School of International Studies at Jawaharlal Nehru University. He was the founding vice chancellor of Sikkim University, and he was also India's representative on the expert group set up by SARC to chart out its future course of action. So I welcome all of you to this discussion. Mr. Sibal, let me begin with you. Why is there an impression that SARC has become merely a symbolic regional forum with little prospect of strengthening regional cooperation? How is it that 30 years, nearly 30 years after the formation of SARC, South Asia remains one of the worst economically integrated regions of the world?
That is true. And to that extent, SARC has not been a success. Though the idea of SARC is a very good one and a necessary one and remains relevant, because everywhere in various regions, they are integrative forces at work. And in this very cohesive, geographically cohesive region, where India is now a rising economy and can, if India succeeds, can also bring benefits all around to the smaller countries, we are not able to put our act together. And the reason, of course, is that one major country of SARC, Pakistan, is impeding the progress towards more trade within SARC and more cooperation on various issues, sensitive issues.
Although they would say it's India which is doing it.
They can say that, but the reality is that if you look at any of the issue which SARC is interested in, whether it is free trade, SAFTA, or terrorism, or connectivity, or whatever else, Pakistan is the odd man out. We have succeeded, though not fully, but with other countries, yeah. And India has moved forward.
We'll discuss this obstacle in greater detail in the discussion. Well, let me move on to our guest from Bangladesh. Now, SARC was a Bangladeshi idea, President Ziaur Rahman's idea in 1980, and it took 5 years to adopt the charter. So when he proposed all this, was he able to foresee the kind of problems this kind of regional integration will face?
Because the idea, I think the vision he had, came out of the common history, culture, the way of life for centuries that this region enjoyed. And that was the binding force that he thought had in mind, that if we have a common market, and it's a market of 1.6 billion people. Can you imagine this? More than 20% of the global population lives here. And if you can simply exploit this potential of 1.6 billion market, and just on the economy of scale, what advantage the people and countries have in this region? And it's not just economic, it's also the cultural, people-to-people, and all the resources that they have in the region, how these resources can be shared. And if just you think of the power sector today, that the some countries have surplus, some others have deficit.
You're talking about the potential. My question is, you know, it was a motherhood and apple pie ideal thing to happen in the region. But were these difficulties foreseen by anybody?
No, difficulties in the way that we have is not a, it's just implementation. I mean, you see, every time there's a SARC meeting and some declaration, it was all agreed upon. It was very high sounding, rather, I would say, very high sounding declarations. And there, I think, implementation level, I think we have been failing. And these implementational failings, Pakistan is an issue, but even leaving Pakistan out, rest of the countries could not put it together, if you like, you know. And if you could do with the rest of the countries and the potentials of the rest of the countries have, if you can put that together, still can make a very big difference in the region. And Pakistan can come in whenever it is ready.
Okay. Professor Lama, do you think that the insistence of some of the SAARC member countries to really not give importance to SAARC and move on to other sub-regional bodies, like, you know, joining, ASEAN, for example, or being part of ASEAN in some form or the other, closer links with ASEAN, BIMSTEC, BMIC corridor initiative, then this South Asian Sub-Regional Economic Cooperation Initiative. So people are actually giving less importance to SAARC and moving on to these sub-regional cooperative ventures. Has that also affected SAARC, that, you know, people have given up on SAARC?
Well, I think all these sub-regional groupings, right, and South Asia's, some of these countries' interest in joining groupings outside the region, including ASEAN, comes out of the fact that we have largely failed in our cooperation venture within the region, right? Mm-hmm. That's why everybody is trying. In any case, you know, the global world is talking about integration, cooperation, and here we are. We have an organized body, we have an institution, even then we have failed to deliver goods. But the question remains here is, you know, if you really look into the history, the first thing we have to remember is this region remained an integrated region. It disintegrated, and again today we are going to trying to integrate. So it is a very difficult process. Yeah. But I would feel that sub-regionalism, if done in a kind of a robust manner, right, could also lead to strengthening of the regional cooperation process.
Okay, so Sibyl, you know, is it are these two things complementary? You could be part of these sub-regional bodies and
I was going to make that point, because if you look at what's happening in Southeast Asia and East Asia, right, you have APEC, you have the TPP now. Now China has proposed a free trade area for the Asia-Pacific region. There is ASEAN itself. There has been an attempt to create an East Asian community. Yeah. Yeah. So if you look to the West, you have I don't know what it's called now, Economic Cooperation Organization. Afghanistan is a member, Central Asian countries are members. There are one or two other organizations of which Pakistan, Afghanistan, Central Asian countries are members. So I see nothing wrong. I think these are complementary. And I'll end by saying that, in fact, I find that there's much greater potential for our countries in this region, in BIMSTEC, rather than in SAARC, because westwards Pakistan will simply block us for geopolitical reasons.
All right.
But east is free to for us, and Bangladesh can, in fact, be a pivot for our look at east policy and our act east policy.
Okay, point well taken. We need to take a break at this point. We'll be back again in a bit. Don't go away. Welcome back. We're discussing the relevance of SAARC. Mr. Chaudhary, do you think that the sheer geographical centrality of India, its geographical size right in the middle of South Asia, the size of its economy, the size of its population, and the fact that it alone can offer connectivity to land connectivity to the neighboring countries of SAARC, do you think that makes bilateral arrangements far more preferable than a tedious multilateral trade agreement?
I think when you're talking about regional cooperation, it is always better to think multilateral.
Why?
Because then it is all encompassing, and that it takes the whole region into it. And of course, India is connected with most of the countries around it. So automatically, India comes into the picture. And also, the concept of bilateralism, sometimes you sort of get bogged down with issues that affects the whole regional potential and expectations that others, the people are hoping to get out of this. So the idea of actually regional cooperation is to get all the countries together, and the potentials of any particular country can be can benefit. Also, other countries. It's like a big market, you know, common market.
So India is not an obstacle to that.
Well, India. Why should India be obstacle to that? Because the whole idea of SAARC is a common market. I mean, like European Union is a common market, and that in the economy of scale, even a small SME in Bhutan can benefit from this market. So to get that all encompassing issues like connectivity and people-to-people contact and trade, free trade in the region, it should all fall in place so that the whole region can benefit.
Okay.
But if you make it just bilateral,
yeah,
then of course you're making the issue sort of more leaving the region out of it, basically.
Okay. Yep, point well made.
Yeah.
Professor Lama, one of the main objectives of SAARC was to accelerate regional economic cooperation. And to that end, SAFTA, or South Asian Free Trade Area Agreement, was signed in Islamabad in 2004. And then, of course, you know, tariffs kept on getting reduced. They said by 2016, there'll be zero tariff, etc. Now, do you think there is adequate amount of trade under SAFTA? Because the last figure I saw was for September 2013, only $3 billion, which is nothing.
You see, the... well, of course, trade figures have improved over the last 10 to 15 years.
But just $3 billion?
Even then, it is a marked improvement, I must tell you. Precisely because today, the intra-regional trade within South Asia would be about 5 to 6%, right? But the question here is, how do we transform this small level of trading to a big trading? Look at China. Right, China and India, China and Bangladesh. If China could do that, why not? So, first important thing is India has to play a very, very pivotal role. And I think India being, the entire SAARC being where India-centric at the moment, right? India has to play a very,
but India did play. India, in fact, brought down its duties for LDCs in SAARC 1 year in advance.
Absolutely
1 year before
right.
the deadline.
Something more substantive. Say, for example, particularly on the connectivity side, particularly on the reducing the cost of trade side,
yeah,
right? Particularly on cutting down all the non-tariff barriers, demolishing all the non-tariff barriers, right? Very, very critical. But you see, trade alone would not suffice for economic cooperation here. There is a huge scope for trading on energy. There's a huge scope for issues related to, you know, on issues which are slightly social in nature, like poverty eradication, right, on exchange of appropriate technologies, right, on exchange of educational services.
There's a lot of potential. But let me just take the connectivity question to Ambassador Sybil. Now, trade can be facilitated through connectivity, land, sea, air. But hasn't air connectivity in South Asia actually gone down? The links have gone down over time.
Very
in the
bad,
last one
yes.
and a half, flights have gone down, or sometimes no flights exist between some of the SAARC countries. This was not always so. You cannot drive from one country to the other, except India to Nepal and Nepal to India. There is no passenger ferry service between the SAARC countries. So, you know, when you say, when Thimphu, they said in the 11th summit that 2010 to 2020 will be a decade of intra-regional connectivity of SAARC. Is that just a slogan? Because you've not been able to sign the SAARC Regional Railways Agreement, SAARC Motor Vehicle Agreement. You talk of Asian Highway, but that Asian Highway never gets built.
I think you're right. Part of the reason is India's poor infrastructure itself. I mean, we've not been able to actually establish good connectivity within the country. We've had these quadrilateral road projects, now quadrilateral rail project. So once this really takes off, then I think the relevant momentum would have been created to extend this connectivity to our neighboring countries. But before we reach that point, there'll be other political steps that need to be taken, because all this will be in the context of a general easing of political tensions, especially westwards. But even with regard to other countries like Bangladesh and this and that, the whole issue of transit, which is a sensitive political issue, Bangladesh government has moved forward, but still a lot has to
Bangladesh
be lot
has
to
moved
be
forward, but India hasn't. For example, would you say, Mr. Chaudhary, that there is a need for India to give transit access to Bangladeshi ports to Nepal and Bhutan? There hasn't been much progress on that.
As a matter of fact, it should be seamless connectivity in the whole region.
Smart borders.
You see, unless smart borders, and unless you have a seamless connectivity, I'm not just talking about roads and bridges. I'm talking about the maritime navigation. I'm talking about the railway. I'm talking about telecom and the rest of it. Because when you talk about the trade, it's a happier position. I don't think it is. The potential is, we can go up to 100 billion if we just ensure the seamless connectivity in the region. Because that is the cost of doing business between, say, Bangladesh and India,
yeah.
is so high that it's cheaper to do North America and Latin America, for example.
Yeah.
It is so higher, the transportation cost, yeah. and the barrier at the custom point, and altogether so it's not really enabling the trade in the region. So unless you have a seamless connectivity across the region, I would not put it down to India, Bangladesh, or Nepal, India. Yeah. I'll put it down to the whole. The idea of SARC is to have the whole region on board.
Till the time, we don't have seamless connectivity, Professor Lama. Can you have sub-regional cooperation within SARC? Say, for example, on the border regions of Bangladesh and India. Can you have a sub-regional ferry service, Calcutta, Dhaka, Colombo? Can you also have border cooperation, Nepal and Bhutan's border with India, build those links? Is that possible?
I think yes, as Ambassador Sibal was saying, that sub-regional cooperation has its own great advantages, right? Most importantly, it takes you away from the national prejudices, right?
Yeah.
But what is very interesting in South Asia is, without knowing the fact that regional cooperation process in South Asia has not been able to, we are not able to consolidate, the sub-regional process has started. Look at India, Bangladesh, the three energy projects which we did, the transmission line between Beramara, and Berampur this side, and Beramara that side, and the sale of electricity to the extent of 500 megawatt. And of course, the
500 megawatt is nothing.
Yeah, no, to start with, this was just simply not thinkable about 10 years back.
Today, we've not been able to do anything on gas. Yeah.
No. But I would
say not even an Eastern grid, forget a SARC grid.
No, but at the same time, let's be very clear about it. This opens up a great opportunity for Nepal and Bhutan to participate in the projects, right? And that is a sub-regional project purely on energy and based on what you call the geographical contiguity.
Okay, we need to take a break at this point. I'll come back to you in a minute. We need to take a break at this point. We'll be back again in a bit. Don't go away. Welcome back. We're discussing the relevance of SARC. Mr. Chaudhary, I interrupted you because we're going on a break, so you wanted to say something.
No, just an extension of what Mr. Lama was saying. And the power can be a tradable product in the region easily.
Yeah.
And I think if you can make it a tradable product in the region, that will have a bigger prospect. And also the same thing can happen with the basin management. The regional cooperation will really help. The water issues, the controversy over water issues can be resolved by the common basin management.
Okay, so that's a very good point. But to change the subject, Ms. Sibal, do you think that domestic problems of SARC members have tended to shape their attitude to regional cooperation? And I would like you to elaborate on India-Pakistan tensions coming in the way of realization of the full potential of SARC.
Yeah, it's quite clear. It's not only problems with Bangladesh. We have with Pakistan. We've had in the past problems with Bangladesh of a political nature, which have hampered trade and investment. In fact, I like to make that point. When you talk about regional cooperation, one should not limit oneself only to trade. There is services and there is investment. And on that, we are far, far behind than other regions in the world. And real economic integration would require that. But coming back to the question you asked, with Sri Lanka, we have serious problems around the Tamilian question. Nepal, you know Nepal well. With Nepal, we have a lot of underlying political problems of attitude. So
wasn't that why bilateral issues were kept out of the SARC charter?
Exactly. Now, so far as Pakistan is concerned, that is the crux of the failure of SARC, because unless Pakistan, as the other major country in SARC in terms of size, cooperates willingly and participates in the processes and does not bring in its bilateral political issues with India into consideration of improving our trade connectivity, etc., SARC simply cannot move forward. Pakistan, I would repeat, is the biggest obstacle to the progress in terms of consolidating.
I think you made that point forcefully enough. Mr. Chaudhary, do you think it's actually the lack of convergence of security concerns, except in the case of, and they're there too only partially, linked to terrorism, and not having a common enemy, you know, these people haven't been able to come together and SAARC hasn't become cohesive. You know, there is no Soviet Union to be taken, a communist system to be taken on by the free market economies of Europe. So there is no commonality of interest in terms of their security concerns.
No, the security concerns, I think as Mr. Lama was saying, this is the integration, it used to be the integrated part, then disintegrated again, reintegrating. So that's a very complicated process. I mean, that trust deficit, of course, is there. I think you can't rule it out. But the best way to do it, that if you can start with trade, and like I agree with him, trade and investment go hand in hand. You cannot have a trade without investment.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And this is very, very important. It's like value addition, I mean, the value chain in the region. Like the clothing industry, if I give you an example, if you can have a proper value chain, the whole region in the clothing alone, clothing and textile alone, will have a very high place in the global market. So I think the trust deficit will go with the measures that the SAARC declarations have been made one after another, high sounding declarations rather. If you can really slowly put them to use, the trust deficit will go away, and security can be addressed with the phasing out of the trust deficit as well as technological intervention. Now there is so much technological intervention on the security issues, and these can be also put to use to do away with the security issues.
But
not completely, but a lot of it.
But let me take just the terrorism question. Okay, there is a SAARC declaration, SAARC Convention on Terrorism. It's become completely infructuous because it requires that member countries pass
enabling laws.
That you declare it a non-political offense, that you try these people, you extradite them. Where extradition is not possible, you allow their trial in another country. All this has not happened. In fact, India says that Pakistan is the main sponsor of terrorism against India. So you don't expect countries to modify their laws on dealing with terrorists. Then how on earth are you going to implement even a general convention like Convention on Terrorism?
Let me just make two points. One is, of course, let's be very clear about it. SAARC has made two significant contributions. One, this is the only forum in South Asia where all the leaders come together every year, right?
And then have a lot of bilateral meetings on the sidelines and do nothing collectively.
Secondly, the SAARC official process has triggered, has sensitized a large number of non-official processes, you know. You get my point. So, for example, today, that's why we say the non-official SAARC is much stronger than the official SAARC.
You mean the NGOs and the civil
NGOs,
societies?
NGOs, all. Educational institutions are cooperating. The lawyers are cooperating. All kinds of environmental activists, right? But the problem in SAARC, as you rightly said, is terrorism. Terrorism is far-fetched, I must tell you. Look at poverty elevation, where there should not be any difference among the SAARC member countries. So in 1993, we said that we will eradicate poverty by 2002 in South Asia. And that was the commission which was set up. And every SAARC declarations after 1993 will say that we will eradicate poverty.
Deadline was 2002 for eradication of poverty under SAARC.
And in 2002, we were all watching very, keenly. And in 2002, the SAARC leaders come together and they again say that we are appointing the second commission.
All right, let me just get, you know, we're running out of time. One more question to you. Which is, does the presence of China as a huge economic powerhouse abutting South Asia have any impact on SAARC and the attitude of member countries to SAARC?
Well, most of our neighbors have played the China card against us over the years, and they continue to play that even now. So therefore, India has suspicions about China gaining even more entry into the South Asian region. And now with the fact that they become such a huge economic power, and with the military power also increasing, having increased very considerably, and with our bilateral problems with China, China is a huge threat.
But what I mean was integrating more the Chinese economy rather than with the
Indian
economy.
Also happening because, you know, Sri Lanka, China is investing huge amounts in Sri Lanka, Bangladesh is doing good trade with with China. So is Nepal. Okay. Pakistan and China are all weather friends. China is a very, very major factor. But one point I'd like to make, the membership of Afghanistan in SAARC is meaningless because of Pakistan.
Okay. You wanted to say something?
I think regional cooperation is not a straitjacket. I mean, it goes beyond that because we are also looking, as you said, the looking east means just we do not restrict to SAARC, go further east and on the, also in the West Asia, in Central Asia. I mean, the whole idea of SAARC is not just to, we have to integrate in the South Asia, but the idea is to take the potential of beyond South Asia.
Okay, one sentence, please. You're running out of time.
We have to do two things now, and we are expecting that at least this time, or when our Honorable Prime Minister goes there, he makes this kind of difference. First is put the entire SAARC process into project mode, one. Secondly, make the SAARC process multifarious, you know, bring civil societies, bring private sectors, bring communities together, and give less importance to governmental ministries.
Okay, let's hope he does that. Let's hope he does that.
Has to be taken care of.
All right, let's hope he does that. We've run out of time. I'd like to thank all of you, Professor Mahendra Lama, Mr. Amir Khusro Mahmood Chaudhary, Ambassador Sybil, for coming here and participating in this discussion. That's all we have for you today. We'll be back again next week with another interesting issue. Till then, goodbye, and thanks for watching.